While it may not have exploded onto the scene with the force of some of its contemporaries, it still didn't take long for Team Cherry's Hollow Knight to be considered one of the greatest indie gaming success stories of the decade. Created by a tiny team of developers, it featured a beautiful, interconnected world, a deep well of lore told as much through setting as through dialogue, and tight, responsive combat against dozens of challenging foes. It's good. You should play it. Now, there are a ton of videos that can be made about this game. There's the incredible level design, the gorgeous music, the rich story, but those videos have all been made already by people much better at this than me. No, for this video, I want to talk about bosses. Or more specifically, one boss. These are the Mantis Lords, and I love them. Now, this boss fight might not be the hardest in the game, or the creepiest, or the most annoying. Just stay still! But what makes it one of my favorite fights, not just in Hollow Knight, but in all of gaming, is how well it's integrated into the world of the game, embodied in the way it's set up and the way it pays off afterwards. So, that's what we're going to talk about. Before we start breaking down the Mantis Lords fight, I want to go into a bit more detail on what I mean when I talk about a boss being well integrated. There's a page on TV Tropes called the Giant Space Flea from Nowhere, which is used to describe those bosses that generally appear out of thin air, have no bearing on the plot, or are complete thematic clashes. But while these bosses are particularly egregious cases, they're really just the extreme end of a problem which I'd argue a lot of boss fights have to some degree, which comes down to a lack of proper setup. Think about how often you've been playing a game, and you've reached the classic big boss fight arena or end of level cutscene, and yet as you enter, you have no real idea of what the upcoming boss is going to look like. Maybe you can roughly surmise that because it's an ice level, it'll be an ice-themed boss, but that's about as far as you can go. Or conversely, think of how many bosses you've fought that, once beaten, are never seen or thought of again. Not only do they never show up again in the story, it's like they just fall out of existence entirely the moment you're done with them. See, here's the thing. Boss fights serve a whole bunch of different purposes in games that use them. To guard the end of a level, to guard a power-up, to test the player can use a specific ability, to progress the story, or just because the designer wanted to hurt you. And because bosses are such a useful multi-purpose tool, games tend to have a lot of them. And because of that, it's hard to give all of them a proper build-up and payoff before the player moves on to the next one. And that can be a problem, because a boss that has no real build-up is relying solely on the fight itself and maybe a brief intro cutscene to make itself memorable. And while that's certainly possible, it results in a lot more heavy lifting that the fight itself needs to be doing. And look, I'm not saying these are bad bosses or bad games that have them, but it is something to think about. If you really want to make a boss stand out and feel like part of a larger story, consider how you can foreshadow them, whether that's giving the player brief flashes of them throughout a level, or having the other enemies and level design really key off them. Or hell, if you really want to go all in, have a whole part of the game entirely based around escaping or weakening or in some way interacting with the boss before the actual fight against them starts. You'll often see that last one in survival horror games, since one of the best ways to build up threat and tension is to put the player in dangerous situations before they can fight back. Okay, enough preamble. Let's talk mantises. Hollow Knight is, for the most part, a pretty open-ended game. While some abilities are needed to use certain routes, often there will be multiple ways in or out of an area. Even the very first boss can be skipped. With that said though, most players' progression through the early game will look something like this. Head through Forgotten Crossroads, beat up the False Knight for the City Crest, obtain Vengeful Spirit and access to Green Path, beat Hornet. Ha! Beat... hang on. Beat Hornet and receive the Mothwing Cloak. Enter the Fungal Wastes, and from there reach the Mantis Village, where the player will receive the Mantis Claw. This is also the point in the game where the player will encounter two new thematically appropriate enemies, the Mantis Youth and the Mantis Warrior. They act as a thematic transition between the Fungal Wastes and the village, but they're more important than that. See, up until this point, all of the standard enemies the player has fought have been either feral wildlife or obviously infected husks. The Mantis Warriors are unique. They're fast, deadly, and quite clearly organized. The player receives warnings about them from Cloth, Cornifer, and Best Boy Quirrell. The game really works to cement in the player's mind the idea that this tribe is strong, want to be respected and treated with a certain amount of caution whenever they're encountered. It all works to build up an image of the tribe, and by extension their leader, before the player even encounters them. The Mantis Warriors also act as a bit of a soft skill check for the player. They're fast enough that you really need to have a good grasp of outmaneuvering an enemy in order to beat them without just face tanking them. This is important because staying mobile in combat is vital for several of the upcoming boss fights, including the lords themselves, so it's good to ensure the player has a solid grasp on it. Once the player does obtain the Mantis Claw, their first instinct is going to be to try it out by getting to all of the previously out of reach goodies in the village area. In doing so, they're all but certain to hit this big ol' switch, which does this. And opens this. The game makes a big show of this new area opening to really draw the player's attention to it and make it stick in their mind if they decide to come back later. And once they do enter, they'll find a challenging descent where they can put their newfound ability to the test. As a side note, this area has the typical excellent Hollow Knight level design. In particular, the way it constantly opens up new shortcuts whenever the player has successfully proved they can navigate past a tricky section. You see that a lot in Crystal Peak as well. Along the way, the player is likely to also find this area, which is currently blocked off by an out-of-reach mantis hitting a switch. We'll come back to that. Finally, the player reaches the open chamber. This is your classic boss arena setup, the sort of thing any seasoned player is going to recognize instantly. And the player is given time to take it all in as they descend. The Mantis Lords loom menacingly in the background, and the entire chamber is built with these three as a central focus. They're clearly aware of the player from the way they perk up as they approach, and everything up until this point, the level design, the enemies, the character dialogue, all of it has been clearly set up, so that even though this is our first time seeing them in person, we have received the message loud and clear that these are some badass ladies. And now, after all of this setup, we have one final masterstroke. The one thing that really pushes this fight over the edge for me. And it's a single word. I'm yet to find someone who doesn't remember this moment as being one of the coolest in the entire game. It puts all of the agency in initiating the fight into the hands of the player, which serves two purposes. First, on the practical side of things, letting the player decide when they want to fight the lords means they effectively get to choose their own difficulty for the fight. But you could argue that's the same for pretty much any optional boss. The more important is the psychological impact, and this really comes down to the specific word choice used. We've just gone through an entire area of the game, being impressed upon constantly how strong and deadly this boss is going to be. And by allowing the player to be the instigator, it gives them an incredible sense of confidence and control. It lets them feel that they're directly telling the game that they will take on its challenge. And it even works both ways. If the player had to challenge every boss in the game, the effect would be diminished, especially when so many of them are in some way mad, mindless, or whatever this is. By challenging a boss, you are implicitly marking your opponent as significant, which is why this ability is reserved for the Mantis Lords, the ghosts of great warriors of the past, or, you know, the sun. Now, for all of this talk of setup and integration, none of this would mean anything if the fight it all centers around wasn't actually, you know, good. Thankfully, the Mantis Lords act as a great showcase of the incredible care that's gone into Hollow Knight's fight design. Boss fights come in all sorts of different kinds. You've got your puzzle boss that requires a specific trick to be defeated, or your standard JRPG boss where you politely smack each other from a distance, or your advancing wall boss that you just need to outrun until you get to a specific predetermined checkpoint, or your classic Nintendo-style boss where you dodge, dodge, hit, repeat. Hollow Knight bosses are mostly of the kind that you can commonly see in Metroidvanias, action adventures, and things like Dark Souls. These bosses are in their essence the most simple. There's no fancy tricks or specific vulnerability windows or special items you need to use. It's just you, your weapon, and your ability to learn a set of attacks and how best to dodge them. Mostly through dying. With these kinds of bosses, there's two hurdles that need to be overcome to beat them. The first is learning their moves and how to dodge, parry, or otherwise avoid them. The second, usually much harder challenge, is being able to think and react on the fly in order to recognize and use the right tactic in time. Generally, that second hurdle is the most fun part of a boss fight. It's not really fun to be hit by a move that you had no idea even existed and couldn't predict. So a good boss fight often wants to have as small a possible selection of varied attacks while still being challenging and unpredictable. It's a delicate balance. The Mantis Lords are a multi-stage boss fight. First you fight the Middle Mantis, who has three moves with minor variations. Two lance attacks, which are dodged in very different ways, and a ranged attack, which requires the player to quickly ascertain the height of the projectile and act accordingly. Each of these moves requires different timing, different responses, and again, notice that mobility we talked about earlier being tested. But still, it's not a massively difficult first stage, roughly on par with the Soul Warrior. Just like in that fight, each move is telegraphed so the player has time to learn the patterns, and each even gives a pretty clear opening to attack back. It'll likely only take a new player a couple of tries to get this down pat, after which they're likely to be thinking, even just unconsciously, that now they've got a good handle on the first one, it's time to learn the attacks for the second. Oh. This is another great design choice for this fight. This second stage completely recontextualizes the first as merely a training session for the real battle. It massively ramps up the difficulty and adrenaline, but it almost completely skips over that first, less fun hurdle where the player has to learn a new set of moves. It's just brilliant. It's rare to see a boss fight that so effortlessly increases in challenge while adding almost no extra complexity. Well, one other boss does come to mind. If the player does choose to fight the Lords at the earliest available opportunity, this will be the fastest, most frenetic fight they've experienced so far. Players returning to it later will probably have an easier time, but still get to experience a beautiful fight against a worthy foe. And for those who want even more challenge, well, okay, I don't really have anything to say about the Sisters of Battle because they're a completely separate bonus boss. I just want to mention them because going solely on the fight alone, they're probably my favorite boss of all time. Anyway. How do you reward a player for beating a boss? Mandatory bosses have an implicit reward of seeing more of the game, whether that's through story progression, new abilities, or opening new areas. Optional bosses need something different. Power-ups. Lore. revenge. Particularly hard bonus bosses might be there solely for the challenge of beating them, but to maintain their impact, they should usually be used sparingly, and not until the very end of a game. However you reward the player, making the reward evocative of the boss it's linked to can really help to keep reminding the player of their achievement. The Mantis Lord's fight rewards the player in three different ways, and each feels like a strong thematic link for the difficult fight the player overcame. First, there's the material gains, the instant gratification. That previously closed off area I mentioned earlier is now available to the player, in which they'll find a geo chest, an all-important bench, and the Mark of Pride charm. Not only is this charm an extremely useful one, the naming of it really ties into that earlier idea that this fight was one of equals. Second, you have gains in terms of story and world progression. That big tantalizing door that the lords were guarding is now open, and you can now gain access to an entirely new area of the game world. Now, this isn't the only entrance into Deep Nest, but it's by far the most obvious, the most accessible, and the most convenient, especially thanks to the bench right outside that the player now has access to. Which means the player is likely to use it multiple times, which means they'll pass through the village and see the lords multiple times, which ties into the third gain, and maybe my favourite touch of this whole boss fight start to finish. I'll tentatively call this a world-building gain. It's a specific change in how the world reacts to you, the player. All of the Mantises in this area, including the lords, are now not only passive to you, but they actively respect you and bow to you whenever they see you. It may sound like such a minor thing, but in addition to making traversal of a tough area much easier, it serves as a constant reminder of your accomplishments. You overcame a difficult challenge, and as a result, the game world itself has marked you as worthy. It also makes for a great callback the first time you go to Queen's Gardens, and there's that uncertainty of, oh hey, a new mantis, I wonder if they're friendly too—
OH GOD!
This permanent transformation of difficult enemy to ally is such a powerful tool in making the player feel like they accomplished something cool and memorable. Outside of JRPGs, where it tends to pop up fairly often, a couple of other notable instances would be the antlion taming quest in Half-Life 2, and I guess legendary Pokemon count.
Eat shit, Lorelei, I tamed a god!
With Silksong finally looking to be coming out of hibernation, there's never been a better time to revisit Hollow Knight and really appreciate what a masterpiece of craft it is. The fact that I was able to spend this long dissecting a single fight, and just the mechanics mind, not even touching on how gorgeous and fluid it is to look at, really shows how much thought and care Team Cherry put into making it feel like a real event, a small but nonetheless indispensable part of a larger story. So next time you're facing down another giant space flea from nowhere, think about how the avenues just explored could be used to improve it. How could it be better built up to feel like a clear and expected progression of the level leading up to it? How can it challenge the player and ramp up the difficulty without overcomplicating things? How could its reward feel like a natural outcome of the fight? And of course, most importantly, could it be more polite?